Wow, what a wonderful wake-up time with a great song, He Has Made Me Glad. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. Isn't it great to be able to be glad in the Spirit with God's guidance in our lives? And what a glorious day that He has brought us. Let's all stand as we sing this great song, Glorious Day. Let's wake up this morning. Here we go.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who can carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was free.
Comes up, let me just take a moment to for y'all to thank this great group of instrumentalists and singers that yes. we've had yes. since we started COVID. We've been doing the two services and they have been here, and I just want to say thank you guys for all that you're doing, for your ministry and for your heart when you come and to help lead worship. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. We would like to welcome you to First Baptist Church. This has been a great week for many of you who were able to participate Thursday in the distribution of food. We distributed over 284 boxes of food and ham and vegetables to people. And one of the things that I got to do, and some of these others, I know Jerry Barnett got to do it as well, I think Peggy Wiggins, was to go around before we distributed those boxes and to have prayer with people. And I can't tell you how many people were so grateful for prayer. They said, you know, we go to a lot of places and we get boxes of food and different help, but no one's ever really asked us to pray. And so I want to encourage you to put on your calendars Thursday, February 25th. That will be the next distribution that we do. And it was just an amazing time. It was great to see people and to know that you are connecting with people that truly are in need. And I think the needs are great. So for all of you who participated in that, there's too many to list for me to name, but I'm so grateful that you were able to. If you were not able to do it on this past Thursday, again, every month for the foreseeable future right now will be the fourth Thursday. When Thursdays with Jesus comes back and we are able to do that in-house, then we'll probably alter the calendar a little bit to do the food distribution on another day. But right now, it's a great opportunity for you to plug in. I want to remind you of that Thursday, February 25th. Also, if you look in the bulletin, you'll see we're back on pretty much a regular schedule for Wednesday night, Sunday night. So we have worship tonight at 6 o'clock. And then on Wednesday nights, you'll pay attention to those times of all the things that are going on, whether it's children or middle school or high school, and the appropriate times for that. I also want to remind you of the children's ministry. Normally, we do a father-daughter banquet. And that's not going to happen this year. It was one of the last main events that we did last year. But the way we're doing, I shouldn't say it's not going to happen. We're just changing the way and the format. We're going to do a box, and you'll read about the details there. It's the reimagined father-daughter banquet. We're going to do a box, which will have the food. It'll have the dessert in it for two people, for fathers and daughters. Those will be available on Friday, February the 12th, to be picked up. And we can even arrange to deliver those if we need to. But we want you to be able to have a special time with your daughter. And so if you've got more than one daughter, you probably want to do more than one box. And I'll just tell you, I don't want to give too much away, but the dessert that's in the box is not just phenomenal, it's phenomenal, okay? It's amazing, okay? And so, in fact, I told Leanne, skip the main course, just give me multiple of the desserts. So that's kind of my prelude. I'm telling you, you will not be disappointed. And look, if you don't have a daughter, you can still order a box. It's okay with us. We don't care. But if you'd like to do that, contact Leanne. Cost is only $10. Let me tell you, for what you're getting, much, much greater than the dessert. Did I mention the dessert? The dessert is amazing. So if you want to support that ministry, and this is just one way, we want you to be able to connect with your daughter, and we want to kind of get back in the swing of things. And I think that we're excited. I know that we're excited as a staff, looking forward to what the spring is going to bring and the summer. We are looking forward to fellowship, 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 fellowship. And as soon as we can do that, we will be offering opportunities for that. If you have prayer requests, make sure that you let those be known. We continue to do prayers on Wednesday night's prayer meeting. And if you haven't joined in on Zoom, that's both live downstairs and also on Zoom. We had 63 people join in on Wednesday evening. We're having greater attendance on that with Zoom and in-house than we ever did otherwise. So that's going to kind of be a mainstay. We'll continue to Zoom for the duration. I want to remind you of a new study, Bible Connection, a study in 1 Peter that will begin on February the 7th. That'll be next Sunday. And also we have a deacons meeting scheduled for next week at 4 p.m. We're delighted to have you today. Take a few moments to greet each other as we welcome each other to worship and as we continue to plug along, seeking Him, purposing our lives in Him as we journey together.
Oh!
possessed to sing to the King and crown Him of many crowns. He died for us. Let us sing our praise to Him this morning. Sing to the King.
Sing to the King who is coming to reign. Glory to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain. Life and salvation His empire shall bring. Joy to the nations when Jesus is King.
Sing that again.
Sing to the King who is coming.
That taught my heart to
has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. An ending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine.
Stand, please, and pray with me. Righteous Lord, we thank you for your amazing grace. True, the earth shall soon dissolve like snow, and the sun forbear to shine, but you will be the light of our life. You will be the light of our hope, and you will be the light of our eternal life. We thank you that we're able to be here today. And so thankful and honored to be able to call you Father. Our spirits will rise unto you. Let us sing your word, for ask it in your name.
There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome. And the shadows
and my faith shall be my life. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise.
Today we're going to be in John, the 15th chapter. John chapter 15. Beginning in verse 5 and going through verse 8. John chapter 15, verses 5 through 8. Jesus saying these words, giving an exquisite metaphor of what it means to be a follower of Christ, not just a nominal Christian, but a Christian who is committed through the thick and the thin of growing in Him. John chapter 15, verses 5 through 8 tells us this: I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Fathers, we come to you today, many of us who are journeying together in faith, many of us who have unanswered questions, and some of us on the edge of doubt and despair. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to heed your words in John chapter 15, to remain in you, to not throw in the towel, to not give up, but a continual abidance and an abiding faith in the person of Christ and who He's called us to be. Grow us, shape us, challenge us, mold us, critique us, deliver us, save us, and call us through you and for your glory. And it's in His name we pray. Amen. And when I was in middle school, there was a contest, and I have had the ability. I've not won the lottery yet, and I haven't won the lottery because I don't play it. I heard that you have to play it to win it, and I'll play it so I don't expect to win it. But if any of you do, I'm never going to question where your money comes from, okay? We won't worry about that. But when I have had the uncanny ability of winning contests, random contests, throughout my life, and one of those was when I was in middle school or in junior high. I won. There was an ad, and you can imagine where I won it. I won it by registering at Belk. There was a contest at Belk, and Kiss 102 FM out of Charlotte. I didn't even listen to Kiss 102 FM. I mean, you know what that's about if you know the title of the radio station. I was never that type of individual. I didn't get into all that kind of music. But I'll accept their gift. And so I won this contest from Belk, a whole wardrobe, a gift certificate to Belk. And then the best part of it was I had limousine service to school for 2 weeks. Now, that's not a big deal today. Kids are like, it doesn't matter to me. I don't know anything about riding in a limousine. You know, a lot of people. But, I mean, this limo had everything. I mean, it was amazing. And so for 2 weeks, you wouldn't believe what kind of friends I had because there was no limit to what I could do with that limo when they, you know, picked me up from school. And so we went to different places, and I dropped them off at the house. And there was one morning that I was supposed to, you know, I was supposed to be picked up at 7:45, as I remember, in the morning, because school started at 8 o'clock. And this particular year, school went, and you'll love this for students, school was from 8 until 3:30. Eight periods. The eighth period was study hall, but you had seven classes during that time. And so that's a long day, 8 to 3:30 in the afternoon. But that's one of the reasons we were able to get out, in May and have a long Christmas break that was a month and a half. But so on a particular morning, I'm supposed to be picked up by this limo, and I'm a person that if you tell me to be somewhere at 8 o'clock, so if I've got to be at school at 8 o'clock, I'm 5 minutes from the school, okay? And so I need to be picked up no later than 10 to 8 so that I'm there at 5 to 8 and I can be in my seat 2 minutes before 8, because, and that kind of stresses me out. I'm a person that likes to be 10 or 15 minutes earlier than the time that I'm supposed to be there. And so I'm sitting there in the living room. My parents have gone to work. My brother's already been taken to school. And so I'm sitting there waiting on my limo ride. And 7:45 comes on, and it's not there. And then 7:46, and 47, and 48. Well, I leave. I leave it. I'm like, I got to get to school. And so I walk to school, a brisk walk. It's about a mile and a half away. I'm in my seat by 8 o'clock. Well, the limo showed up at 8, but I wasn't there to receive it. And there was kind of we had this issue. My father called and said, look, you know, you have to be on time. You know, he's got to be at school. And so, he showed up eventually to provide me the ride that I had secured. But I had grown impatient of waiting. And as a result of growing impatient for waiting, I jumped the gun and I got there. Now, what he told my father was, well, actually, I got there. I just must have missed him by accident because I would have been in school on time. And one of the things I want to encourage you in the Christian life is, just as this illustrates, is that there are many times that we grow impatient of God's timing. There are many times that we jump the gun, and it's not to say that it's bad. I mean, listen, I'm grateful, and God is grateful for many of us that are centered in His will. But a part of His will is the timing of things. And so many people have gotten frustrated at the timing. And they either jump the gun or they quit altogether. And let me ask you, how many of you have ever in your walk with God grown frustrated and impatient with Him? And what happened when you did? Did you jump the gun? Sometimes you probably did. And what happens when you jump the gun? You may arrive at the same place. You may arrive at the same opportunity, but it's going to be different had you waited on the Lord. Jesus says to His audience here in John chapter 15, He introduces this metaphor. I am the vine and you are the branches. He says, if a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Now, several years ago, I had an opportunity to do a wedding at the Watauga Winery. Okay, I don't know if you've ever been up there, but if you go to the Watauga Winery and you see the house that's been built where the couple that owns this place and they have a venue for a wedding, and there's grapes on the hillside. If you go up there to this particular place and look out over the hill country, you will buy into the reality, and I can show you pictures of that. You will think you're in Tuscany because the house is Italian. It's very Italian, and they ordered the stones from Italy to build this home. It's a beautiful countryside of vineyards. I mean, as far as you can see, vineyards that overlook the hillside. Now, the thing about it is, if I'm a person that has a vineyard, I'm going to have to wait on that vineyard to produce the grapes. No fruit is automatic. It's not. There's a process. There is long patience that has to wait. We have to wait to bear the fruit. If we're in Christ, and I see this a lot, people come to faith in Christ and they just want to be, they're ready to go. I'm ready to serve. I want to do. Let's go. There's something to be said, though, for growing in Him, remaining in Him. Many people come to faith, okay? And I've had multiple people in my life come to faith, and they'll give a statement like, well, I don't understand why this person's upset at me, or this person's angry at me, or this person's disappointed at me, because I've accepted Jesus. Just because you accept Christ doesn't mean that you bear fruit. Fruit bearing is patient serving, patient abiding, consistently abiding on the vine of God and allowing Him to produce in us the fruit that He has intended us to produce. If I look in John chapter 15, what is, you know, is a big picture of it, John chapter 15 is an understanding to the audience that every single one of us has a purpose. And our purpose is to bear fruit. That's why we are on the vine. We're not on the vine to look pretty. We're not on the vine just to be green. Our purpose is to bear fruit. Now, you can go and you can look at those vineyards today, and they're probably gorgeous, okay? And there are plenty of places that have beautiful vineyards, but guess what? If the vine does not produce fruit, it doesn't matter how pretty it is. The vineyard will go bankrupt because the value of the vine is the fruit that is produced, okay? The value of the vine spiritually is the fruit that God produces in us as a result of us staying and being and abiding on the vine. The purpose of a grapevine is to produce grapes. Beautiful vineyards without grapes can be beautiful, but that is not God's intended purpose. Now, being beautiful is not a bad thing, but, you know, many times of the Christian life, there's a lot of things that we do that are just fine and good, but they're not necessarily God. They're not necessarily of Him or caused by Him, or we're not exhibiting fruit that's produced by Him. God's will is always got His interest in mind. And His interest and His plan and His will is always going to be for our betterment. In fact, we reach our greatest point in life when we're centered in Him. We don't need to be ahead of Him. We don't need to be behind Him. We need to be with Him, abiding in Him, patiently serving and growing on the vine and producing the fruit that He wants us to produce. The call to faith is a call to wait on the Lord. Because God is able to see much more than what we can see. God is able to anticipate much more than we can anticipate. And I go back and I'll never forget in 2003 when I entered the pastorate for the first time, I had a deacon's meeting, and one of the deacons said, you know, how long do you see yourself here? And one of the reasons that he asked that is because that church had been a revolving door, because it was a seminary church. Seminary students would come in, and so when seminary students graduated, I mean, for its history, it had only been around about 50 years. For the 50 years that it existed, it had been a revolving door of seminarians. And so I had a graduation date of 2002. I had gone, December 2002, I'd gone on staff there in actually the Sunday after September 11th, September 16th of 2001. And so when they found out my graduation date was December, they started withdrawing from me. I mean, I was a minister of music. They started withdrawing from me in September. And I couldn't figure, I was like, what are you, I mean, like they wouldn't, they. I mean, like, you're not going to be here. I'm like, why am I not going to be here? Well, you're going to leave. And when you graduate, I'm like, I've not put that out there. Well, that's just what everybody does. And so I ended up staying there. As circumstances would have it, I would be called as a pastor in June of 2003. But I remember when the deacon asked that question, how long are you going to be here? And I said, I could stay here forever. I don't ever see myself. I mean, I'm perfectly happy, and I've told the staff, you know, I would go to conferences in 2004 and 2005, and a lot of those were at Beeson Divinity School at Samford University in Birmingham, Alabama, and there was a pastor's conference that was funded through an endowment, and it was a week-long intensive training, and it was $100. $100 provided the training, food, and lodging for the week. It was by far the best deal that I've ever heard of as far as training. And you would, you know, these people would pour into you all day, and then you'd have fellowships at night, and you would network with people. But one of the things I realized is in the networking, a lot of the networking was people sharing their war stories of how they've been hurt and the conflict. And I was like, I'm not having any of that. I don't understand. And I didn't, you know, until Hurricane Katrina hit. And Hurricane Katrina, while it destroyed much of the Gulf Coast, it didn't destroy our area. But what it obliterated were the people that were not solidly abiding on the vine. And it absolutely rendered chaos. In one day, overnight, a fourth of my congregation's employment transitioned to Houston, Texas. So one-fourth of the budget, gone. Now, when that happens, you know, people like me, we don't really get worried God's going to provide. But the people who are the money people, the figureheads of the, or, and I don't mean that literally, but the ones that focus and fixate on the figures and the counting of the money, they're like, you know, I mean, that sends them into pandemonium. They just, oh my gosh, we're not going to be able to afford any of that. When I look at that experience that would evolve over the next 18 to 24 months, it absolutely, numerous conflicts erupted that you just couldn't anticipate. I mean, I'd be in a meeting at some point. It'd be like having Peggy Wiggins in a meeting and Sterling in a meeting, and they've never had a harsh word at all to one another. And all of a sudden, Sterling lunges at Peggy in the middle of a meeting. I mean, and just goes after her, just goes for the jugular. And I'm witnessing. I'm like, what in the world has gotten into these people? Stress, anxiety, fear, doubt, bewilderment, impatience. I told the staff over the last 2 weeks, that my concern is not the physical health. I mean, I am concerned about your physical health, but that's not my primary concern and has not been my primary concern since the beginning of 2020. It's a spiritual health. Because when you compound anxiety and overwhelming and all these things that are being thrown at us, it wears on the soul, it wears on our patience, and we grow impatient. And I said, get ready. Because you're going to see and you're going to witness conflict after conflict and things that you didn't see before. And when that happens, you don't need to return it for what it is. You just back up. Woo! I think we need to take a chill pill. Need to calm down. And a lot of people, listen, and some of you are going to do that. Some of you who are tuned in are going to do that. And that we would just want to diffuse it. It's a reality that is, and what it is in this time and in the future, there's going to be a growing impatience. You're going to say things like, we just need to do. We just got to do this. Be patient. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, you know it well. Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Abide in Him on the vine and produce the fruit that He desires us to produce. We must, secondly, remain in Him. If you look in verse 5 of the passage, He says it, I'm the vine, you're the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Producing fruit takes time. How much time? I don't know. It's God's timing. You know, early December, I had purchased one of these kits, an herb growing kit. And it's a little thing that you put these pods in, it sprouts, and you can have fresh herbs year round. And so I planted it, and I was like, dadgummit, I wanted to make my dill pickles. Where's the dill? I mean, and I would sit and watch it, and every day I would go and look, and I'm like, produce! This is ridiculous. I mean, it's miracle growth, for God's sakes. It needs to be producing. It needs to be growing. So I left for my parents before Christmas. Nothing. I'm like, pods were bad. I went online. I ordered new pods to arrive the day after Christmas. Why? Because I was impatient. I didn't wait. So I spent $15 on these pods. I get back, you know, a week later, 6 days later, all five of my pods had produced fruit. Guess what? It didn't produce it when I wanted it. I want it now. How many of you have wanted something now? You know, it's fine when it's $15 pod. God can use it as an illustration of those who wait on the Lord. But with life, the stakes are much higher. Sometimes we miss the best God-given opportunities. His stamp of approval, His purpose. We miss the opportunity to grow in Him. We miss the opportunity to remain in Him. We miss the opportunity of togetherness on the vine. Because we get rushed. Because of ambition. Because of stress. Because of being overwhelmed. We cannot get weary while we are waiting. We just need to look forward with great anticipation of what God is going to do and how He's going to call us and how He's going to use us. You know, one of the things I had shared, our plans for 2020, we had two trips in mind. It's two trips, Germany and Switzerland, and people paid for those trips and flights and all these things. And Dave Cannon and I went on a kind of exploratory trip in May of 2019, excited about all the things we're going to be able to do. We had a great time. I'm not going to talk a lot about it, but we had a great time. And we look forward to that. And then suddenly, just slips out of our hands. God, what was your purpose in that? What was your purpose in sending us there? What was your purpose in doing this? Because now what I've come to realize, unless a tremendous miracle and act of God, which could happen, Switzerland is kind of closed. That opportunity is shut down just the results of there's been transition from staff of that location, and so they've moved to northern Germany, so there's still opportunity in northern Germany. But I look at that and I think, you know, it would be easy, and because right now on the calendar penciled in is August of 2021. Here's the thing. August of 2021 probably needs to be an intensive fellowship here at First Baptist Church. To pour our resources into one another. To have a huge barbecue. What I like to see. A pig picking, if you will, on the grounds. I'm telling you, I am so excited about all the food we're going to be able to eat. I'm looking forward with great anticipation. The fruit, I can see it forming on the vine, and I just can't wait until God says it's time to pluck it. I can't wait. I can promise you this, I will never take for granted again any fellowship. And here's the thing, over the years, the one area that the church has thrived in, or the churches I've sort of thrived in more than anything else, has been fellowship. And that is the main one that we have been starved of in this season. What is God trying to communicate to us about fellowship and worship and discipleship? I think one of the things, absolutely, don't take for granted the ability to connect with one another. Because when you're on the vine and you're abiding in Him, you're not alone. There's a lot of other fruit on that vine. There's a lot of other grapes. There's a lot of things in store for you and for us. Don't get ahead of Him. Don't lag behind Him. But be centered and remain in Him. God's timing is perfect. It cannot be rushed. Just as our demands on the fruit we want to produce cannot be rushed. God's will is perfect. It happens just when He wants it to happen. And if you're like me, maybe you would characterize yourself as a Christian in a hurry. I've thought a lot about that. Because patience is not one of the virtues that's been a part of my design. And I would say this, when I looked at the fruit of the Spirit, I used to look at it as, patience is my weak, I'm not going to focus on that. I'm just going to focus on maximizing on those other areas. You know the interesting thing about the fruit? You don't get to choose the fruit that you bear. The fruit of the Spirit is all of that. Notice it's not fruits of the Spirit. I read into that for years. It's fruits of the Spirit. That's what I thought to myself. So I'm not going to focus on patience because I'm weak in that. I'm going to focus on those other areas. But when you really look at it, it's fruit, singular. The fruit of the Spirit exemplifies these things. So you and I don't get to pick and choose which characteristic we want to focus on. We have to be determined and committed to focusing on all of them. One of the things I think the struggle for my walk has been patience. Wait on the Lord. Know His timing. Abide in Him. And it's amazing because, you like to think that you're waiting on Him, but then you find this sense of anxiety inside, when there's a schedule. We got a schedule. Like I'm looking up at that clock. I've got 7 minutes. You know what? I have all the time I need. Now, that doesn't mean that you're not going to get up and walk out. But I have all the time that I need. I mean, we're so confined to the tick-tock of the watch and of the clock. God does not obey the clock. God is over the clock. I mean, let's think about it. If you think about time in the year, this is the year 2021 A.D., Anno Domini, in the year of our Lord. So even time is defined by Him. Now, we don't attribute it that. We don't think that every day. But time is His. And time is nothing to God. I mean, God is. He's present. That's it. So he always has been, he always will be. So time, how much time does it take to produce the fruit that he wants us to produce? As long as he wants it to. But it's not automatic. It comes from abiding in him. I was I went to Books A Million yesterday, and I noticed a new book. I started to pick it up, but it was cheaper on Amazon, so I didn't buy it. But it was the title of it was Saints, and the subtitle was Moving from Being a Christian to Being a Saint. And I kind of looked, I opened the book, it intrigued my interest, and so I looked at the book, and I could tell that the whole book's purpose was to argue against that so many of us satisfy ourselves, or we're satisfied by just entering the pearly gate, so to speak. We're not going to do any more. We want just enough of Jesus to pass us over the threshold or to carry us over the threshold. And the argument of this book is, no, the purpose of Christian faith is to produce the saint out of the sinner, to transition a person that's merely a follower of Jesus to one who is abiding in Christ every day. And we wonder why followers of Jesus are not producing fruit. It is because we are not abiding in him. You wonder why someone who's baptized 30 years ago, and you look at them then and you look at them now, and there's no qualitative difference between that moment they accepted Christ in the here and now, although time has passed. It's because they signed up to be a part of the club, but they didn't do anything to abide in the organization and in the person who inaugurated or started the invitation to begin with. Christ is not asking us just to come forward and to be baptized and to join his church. Christ is bidding us to come and die to self and then to set our lives on fire, to borrow a phrase from John Wesley, and so that when we set ourselves aflame, that we will be a beacon of light for a world and the world will take notice, and we will empty ourselves of what we want and what we want to pursue, that, and as a result of abiding in him, his will becomes ours. Our will becomes his. He is the vine. We are the branches. A Christian in a hurry serving God will find herself in the hurry as expressing doubt. The reason that we are hurried is because we are frantically pursuing what we believe God wants us to pursue, but we get antsy about the time. And so we rush ahead to do things without abiding in him. And there's multiple examples of this in my own life. There's multiple examples of it in your life. And what we need to do is to put a pause and rest. I can assure you today that no grape on the vine is rushing to grow. It's nourishment and it's delivery to become the fruit that the owner wants is dictated by the time that it takes to produce and make it to the fullest maturity. Too many Christians today continue to drink the milk from yesterday. We are perpetually infant. Perpetually infants. We're not even children in the faith, adolescents in the faith. Producing fruit in us means that we are abiding in him and he is growing us in his timing. And the hope is that, ladies and gentlemen, and there's not a certain age that this happens, but the hope is that we become mature followers of King. And as a result of maturity, that we bear the fruit, and other people see the fruit that we're bearing, and they too will want the same thing. And that they can help us in guiding and steering us to wait. To wait. To wait. There is a perfect time for everything. And it is God's timing. Knowing God's timing is critical to our faithfulness. Sometimes we doubt that God is going to show up. And so we jump the gun, just like what I did when I was waiting on that ride. I got antsy. I got impatient. I got to go. And so I went. I missed the ride, even though the ride showed up. You don't want to miss what God desires to do in your life because of your impatience. And over the years, I remember in Louisiana, someone said, we had two services. We'd gone back to one during a building campaign. And I was approached by someone that wanted to do a ministry opportunity. And I said, let's pray about it. Let's think about it. And see, when I tell you to pray about it and think about it, I'm not using prayer as a crutch to pause. Now, some people do that. I'll pray about it. When I tell you to pray about it or let me pray about it, I genuinely mean that. Let me pray about it and let me, think. And so I created a form. That's what I call church bureaucracy. I created a form for people that had ministry ideas to look at the form, and it tried to troubleshoot a lot of the questions to make them think about a lot of the things that they need to think about. And what happened is this. It ticked some people off. Because what I was trying to do was to have them think through things, and it ticked them off because they're like, I'm not going to do the paperwork. This is just another hoop to jump through. And the reality is, ladies and gentlemen, that those individuals who grew impatient, and they start, and the purpose was to have another worship service, okay? They want to have another contemporary worship service. But see, in the big picture of things, there's one church. My role is to ensure that we have one church, not multiple services with multiple churches. Okay, that's my role. And so, but they couldn't see that. I mean, they wanted what they wanted. And so I show up one morning at 8 o'clock, which I normally worship was at 10:45, like what it used to be here. I show up one morning at 8 o'clock, and there are people in the parking lot, and there's a worship service going on. And so I walk in, and I'm like, well, I sat. I sat down, and we had worship. And I said, what are you doing? And he said, well, I wanted to have a worship service. I wanted to do this. And I said, okay. I said, but did you not think that, who's going to, we're not preaching. We're not doing any preaching. We're just having a worship service. And so one of the things, and what happened? It lasted, okay, because here's the thing. Who was coming to the 8 o'clock service? The target were people with children. People with children don't typically come to 8 o'clock services, people. You'd have to inconvenience the 11 o'clock service and move those people to the 8 and allow the children, families with children to come. So it lasted 4 weeks. And it fizzled. And he was disgruntled and he was upset. And he came to me and he said, I don't understand. I said, because you have to be, there's so many plans that go into doing these types of things. Now, here's the damage that was done. 2 years later, there was a genuine need to start a worship service. And do you know what was said to me? We already tried that. It fizzled. It died. So I want to encourage you. I bet you there's things and opportunities here that you've done, and we got ahead of things, and they fizzled and they died, and your thought process has been, well, we've already tried that. Did you try doing it waiting on the Lord? I think there's a huge difference. Just because you've done it and succeeded before doesn't mean that you can do it again and succeed again. And just because you did it before and it failed doesn't mean that if you do it again, it will fail. The question always has to be, God, how can we be faithful to what you want us to accomplish? How can we be faithful to your will? And what he's saying above all in John chapter 15, Faithfulness is linked to abiding in the God who causes fruit to bear. God's will be done in verse 7. When we ask something of God in pursuit on the path of obedience, what we ask will be given. Why? Because everything that we ask will automatically be centered in His will because we're abiding in His will. And this is not a prescription, ask whatever you want and you get it. This is because you're abiding in Him and you're remaining in Him and your whole countenance is attached to Him, then everything that comes as a result of your heart's desire is going to be what God has planted in it. And it will be done because your heart and God's heart are aligned. Your will and God's will is aligned. And our wills and our decisions and our actions will emanate from the God who's working in us. His will, our prayers will be answered. We will receive exactly what we ask because we won't ask for anything that He's not seeking to accomplish or to do. Because when we're seeking His will, we're not seeking what we want. We're seeking what He desires. God's will is that we will be His disciples. And the criterion through which discipleship is evaluated in John chapter 15 is the ability to bear fruit. You may look good today. You may feel good today. You may look plush today. You may look well put together today. But if you and I are not producing fruit, God has this question for you. Where's your faithfulness? And how are you demonstrating that you are my disciple? Father, we thank you for our time together today. And Lord, as we look in John chapter 15, as you are the vine and we are the branches, help us to bear the fruit that we need to bear for your kingdom. Help us to be centered in your will. Forgive us for jumping the gun. Forgive us of being impatient. May we produce the fruit of the Spirit through Christ, in Christ, and for Christ as we remain in you, your timing. Produce in us the fruit in your season. And it's in His name we pray. Amen. This is the invitation this morning. If you're here this morning and you've not been bearing fruit, or maybe you are impatient, maybe there's areas of your life that you've just grown disgruntled with, just kind of step back from those circumstances and ask yourself this question: God, am I bearing the fruit that you want me to bear? Am I a disciple? Am I truly a disciple? Not am I a believer. You may be a believer. So was the devil. The devil believed in Jesus. He believed that He existed. Are you a disciple of Jesus Christ? Are you bearing fruit? Are you producing the fruit of the Spirit of God? This is the invitation. The invitation is to come, to receive Him, to produce fruit through Him, to abide in Him as we are disciples together on this journey. Won't you stand? Won't you sing as we respond this morning?
Come. Soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and He will surely give you rest by trusting in His word. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust. Now into the crimson flood. blood that washes white as snow. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now. He will save you, He will save you, He will save you now.
Father, as we come to you at the close of this service, we pray, Lord, that you would help us in our fellowship of you. Help us to be obedient to you, abide in you through thick and thin, to create a patience within us. And Father, may we have long obedience in the same direction, to borrow the words from Eugene Peterson, to seek to know you, to be determined and committed to your will, and to move only when your Spirit moves upon us. To God be the glory, and it's in His name we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming.